Hello, I'm Dan Oliver with the Government Affairs Committee of the Chamber of Commerce. We're happy to have you with us this afternoon for our forum Onslow, the candidate forum for our Board of Education members, and we look forward to a good afternoon with you. The Government Affairs Committee works with local government agencies to work on issues that are important to our business community. They also monitor legislation that may have impact on the business community and try to be sure our voice is heard. The other area that we focus energy is in partnerships to bring together business and government, our military in this community, as well as the education leaders of our community, to build the relationships that we need to succeed. Employers want well-trained students, so what we're talking about this afternoon are particularly important to the business community. We thank our candidates for being here today. Obviously, in our system of government, you have to have folks who are willing to step forward and commit themselves to serve, in this case, to serve us on that most important process in life of bringing those young minds to a state that they can either pursue additional education or that they enter the workforce. We're very pleased to have all of our candidates with us. We'd like to thank our media sponsors, the Daily News and the City of Jacksonville, for the use of this fine facility. Works wonderfully every time. And also the City of Jacksonville's media team for helping get this broadcast today. This is a very important forum to show you the candidates that will be running for these important offices. Our corporate sponsor today is Duke Energy. I'd ask that you help me welcome Bob Dupuy to the podium. Bob is the federal accounts executive for Duke and also serves as the Chamber's division chair for the Military Affairs Committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan, and well said on what we're here for. So greetings all, and a special greetings to the candidates. Thank you for wanting to be part of the leadership that will define our community. So it's an honor to be here with you today. And on behalf of the Duke Energy employees in and around Jacksonville, Onslow County, we're so proud to partner with the Jacksonville Onslow Chamber of Commerce, with the Daily News, with the City of Jacksonville, to bring you these important and informative forums. I can't say it any better than Dan did, so I'll stop as to why we're here. And I'd like to introduce our moderator for this afternoon, Elliot Potter. Elliot has been moderating these forums for us since the beginning of time, I think is the correct answer. He's a veteran journalist who served as editor for the Daily News for more than 34 years and is now co-host for the Rayford Brown and Friends show on Thunder Country 96.3. Elliot? It's all yours, sir.
Thanks, Bob. And I want to echo what he had to say about welcoming the candidates. It takes a little bit of guts to get up here and answer these questions. It's not what you do in your everyday life, so we understand that. I want to also introduce
my colleagues here at the table, because I'm going to need their help as the night goes on, or as the afternoon goes on. And it's Anna Davin here is going to be the timekeeper, so keep an eye on her. She's going to have some information for you that you're going to need to follow. And Sandra Gilmore is going to be helping me tonight with the selection of the folks. We're going to try to rotate order a little bit differently than we have in the past. One of the things we're trying to avoid here is going in the same direction, starting with the same person, you know, having one person always follow the same person, so that if we can do this, if we can pull this off, we can give ourselves a big pat on the back for maybe correcting a little shortcoming in the program. But whether we can pull it off is something that we, I guess, we'll see as the night goes on. We do want to make this informative and enjoyable, and I want to go over a few of the rules that we're going to be using so that we can make that happen. First, I want to talk about the fact that this is the Chamber's forum, but it's also the people's forum, and we try to give people a chance to participate in the questioning. And again, tonight, the people that are here in the audience will have a chance to do that. They can write, and we already have quite a few questions that have been submitted. Those in attendance can write their questions on a card that is being provided, and they can pass it to a Chamber representative who will come over and collect them. During the evening, we're going to try to work some of these questions. No way that we can work them all into it, but we're going to try to work some of the questions into the questions that we're going to submit to you. I would ask those in the audience that and remind them that they don't know who will answer the questions, so the questions should be general in nature and not addressed to an individual. Okay, some of the other rules that I want to talk about is, when we're going to have like three stages of this. One is an opening statement that each of you will have a chance to provide, and the length of that statement will be 1 minute. You will also have a chance to answer the questions that I pose to you. We'll have probably an hour or so of that, which I'll be posing questions. You have 60 seconds to provide your response. Now, again, we're going to select somebody to start, and then we're going to rotate the direction we're going to go into. So pay close attention to that, and I'll try not to confuse you or myself. At the end of the responses, each candidate will also have a chance to add 30-second rebuttals. You have two rebuttal cards there in front of you, the yellow cards. If during the course of the questions you have something you would like to add or perhaps like to respond to, you just hold up your card, and when the questions are finished or when the answers are finished, we will recognize you, and you will have another 30 seconds to provide an additional information that you would like to bring to the attention of the audience. So is there any questions about that, the rebuttal cards? I know this is the first time we've used that in the school board race, but it's really okay, and it works pretty well. We found out that it gets a lot of information out there. At the end, the rebuttals are 30 seconds. As a reminder, at the end you will have summations. They will be 1 minute, and as far as the timekeeper goes, during the 1 minute questions or 1 minute segments, you will be shown the yellow light with 15 seconds to go. During the 30 second summations, you will be shown the yellow light with 10 seconds to go. So that's kind of the way it works. If you're talking, just finish your sentence and then we'll cut it off. I like to stay as close to that time limit as I can, and people in the past have done a really good job of that. I think that about covers it. This is a forum. It's not a debate, so present your responses to the audience, to the voters, rather than each other. I know everybody gets all excited about what they see on television, but we're going to try to avoid some of that little show. Dog and pony show, okay? All right, let's open it up with the general statement. And Sandra, who's going to get it started?
Good afternoon, and we will start with Jonathan Merritt.
Okay, Jonathan.
And go to my right.
Okay, we'll just move right down the table.
Good afternoon. My name is Jonathan Merritt, and I'm running as a conservative candidate for the Onslow County Board of Education. I live in the Richlands community with my wife and two kids. I'm an instructor at James Brunk Community College in Kenansville, North Carolina, and I'm the lead instructor for the Diesel and Heavy Equipment Technology Program. I decided, after a whole lot of talking with friends and family, that I think I can make a difference in Onslow County in the education system. I've got the experience, I've got the knowledge, and I've got a few ideas based on my experience at the community college level. I think we definitely need to expand our access and offerings of career technical education, which is the program that I'm involved in. We need to express or increase participation in Career and College Promise program, and we need to improve our performance. We've got a little bit of an issue going on performance-wise, and I think we've got some ways to increase that.
Mr. Earl Taylor.
My name is Earl Taylor, and I reside in the White Oak District. I'm a graduate of East Carolina University with degrees in music education and school administration. I am a retired educator with the Onslow County Schools with 35 years of service. My experiences included serving as the band director at White Oak High School and Tabernacle Middle School. I later served at the district level for 20 years as Director of Arts Education, then middle schools, and community affairs. I was first elected to my first term on the school board in 2012. I also serve as an adjunct music instructor at Coastal Carolina Community College. I remain very active in my community, serving on several boards, including Crime Stoppers, the Onslow Chapter of the North Carolina Symphony, and SAT Incorporated. My wife and I have two children, both products of the Onslow County School System, graduates of White Oak High School and East Carolina University.
Thank you. Ms. Pam Thomas.
Well, I'm Pam Thomas, and of course, you know that I'm running for the Board of Education. I've served on the board for 12 years, and during that time, I have seen so much change in our education system. I was raised in Onslow County. I was educated in Onslow County, went to East Carolina, and I have several degrees from there and master's degrees. But my important things are what I've done in the school system. I believe that anything I say to you today is not as important as what actions and works I've done with the school system and with our county. My family still resides here in Onslow County, and they say I'm always too busy because I'm doing a lot of things, and I want to continue to do that. I have a definite passion for education, and I'm a strong advocate for public schools.
And we'll move to Ms. DeWanna Turner.
Thank you, Ms. Alley. My name is DeWanna Turner, and my family and I, we live here in Jacksonville. My husband and my three children, and I also have a foster son. I've been here in Onslow County for about 12 years. After retiring from the United States Navy, 24 years of honorable service in 2013, I took on a director's position at the Onslow Pregnancy Resource Center as the Sexual Risk Avoidance Program Director. I am also a substitute teacher with the Onslow County School System. I have an interest in the future education of our children. You know, one of the purposes of educating our children is to someday take our place in society. Well, I want to be part of that process. I desire to ensure that our children grow and develop them to be positive contributors to our community and our society.
Mr. Paul Wiggins.
It is my pleasure to have this opportunity to share with you who I am and why I would like to be reelected to the Onslow County School Board. I was born and reared in Onslow County. I love Onslow County and its people. We have so much to be proud of. Our potential is unlimited. I am equally proud of our school system. My brothers, my wife, and my three children are all products of the Onslow County school system. I was in the first grade at then Thompson Elementary, second through eighth at Clyde Irwin, and graduated from Jacksonville High School. After attending Appalachian State University, I returned to Onslow County to teach 17 years at Dixon High School, 5 years at Swansburg Middle, and 17 years as the principal at White Oak High School. I've been blessed to serve as a teacher, a coach, an athletic director, an assistant principal, and principal. Education has been my passion and my God-given talent, and I just want to continue to share that passion with the youngsters of Onslow County.
Thank you. All right, now we'll move on to the question, and we will start with
DeWanna Turner, and we'll go to the left.
Okay, here we go. And Ms. Turner, the first question is, what do you see as the greatest strength of the Onslow County schools and the system's greatest shortcoming?
At present, as the Onslow County school system stands right now, I think the strength of one of the strengths are they care about our children, regardless of the avenues in which education is taken. At the end of the day, the educators, the teachers, they care about our children. Some of the weaknesses is the methods of methods in which we use to educate our children, I believe, is some of the weaknesses, such as curriculums or standards. At this time, with the school report cards coming out, that's the gradings with those. We had some low test scores with a lot of the schools had low test scores. So I think that is one of the weaknesses, and that's something that we can improve on.
Ms. Thomas, I believe you're next.
Oh, I thought you said you were going left. Sorry.
I believe we're going to Ireland.
You're right.
She went to East Carolina.
We're not going there.
And I'm proud that I'm from East
there
Carolina.
You go.
I think that our strengths Was that the question, our strengths?
What do you think the greatest strength is, and what do you think the greatest shortcoming is?
I think our greatest strength is that we have partnerships throughout this community. We have bases, which many of you attend. We have businesses that come into our schools that we don't even know until later what they're doing for our students. We have individuals and civic organizations who operate to help us provide resources, even food and take-home food for our kids, to provide books for us. Another strength that we have is that we have a diverse clientele. It has made us stronger. It's made us able to initiate some special programs like our immersion program that we would never have been able to have done 20 years ago. But the diversity of our community has allowed that.
Mr. Taylor?
I agree with Ms. Thomas. Certainly, the community support that we have from our businesses and our civic organization. We serve as a model with our BASIS program, and that program has been emulated throughout the state. We get calls constantly about that. So that certainly is a plus, the diversity among our students and our staff. We've got teachers from all over the world that are teaching in our schools. That is a plus for us. I think equity, as far as quality programming from one school to the next, a parent can pretty much choose where they'd like to go and get a good quality education for their children. As far as a weakness, you may say, it is increasingly becoming more difficult to find teachers. There is such a great shortage of teachers in North Carolina that it's very scary. So, but in the meantime, we have a quality force, and with the diversity in the military community, we're able to fill those positions.
Thank you. Mr. Merritt.
Thank you. I think our biggest strength is the dedication and commitment of our instructors, our teachers. We've got many that I've talked to over the last several weeks that raised here, teach here, and want to stay here. Without them, we don't have anything. The weaknesses I see are, one is across the country, is our reliance on federal funds and federal rules. The department, or the U.S. Department of Education, gives you money, but they give you certain stipulations or certain rules and regulations you have to follow by, and I think we need to step out from under those and make our own rules at the local level. Government is meant to work from the ground up, from the citizen up. It's not meant to come from the top down, and I think we need to have our citizens get back in it and take it from a weakness to a strength and work from the ground up.
And Mr. Wiggins.
Ditto. combination of things, one which is a strength and a weakness together. Certainly our strength, we do have dedicated teachers, very talented. On the other hand, the weakness, we're having more trouble getting teachers at the college level with the UNC system. There are 17% less enrolling in the teaching profession. We need to gain the respect back for one of the most noble professions, and that's teaching. Another strength that I think that we have is our caring community. The teamwork that goes on with us with the base and us with Coastal Carolina, our community is known for its teamwork, and I think that's a real strength for us. Our EC program, many of the military families tell me the reason that they come to Onslow County is because of the reputation of the strength of our EC program. So we're very proud of that.
Thank you very much. We've had quite a few questions that have been turned in, and a lot of those questions have to do with the issue of accessibility to the public. So I'm going to try to combine some of those and ask you, how would you rate the school system's accessibility to parents and the general public? And to discuss things like maybe how you can open up board meetings, or perhaps after board meetings, some association with the citizenry, or even the idea, one questioner has raised the idea of town hall meetings that would be different than board meetings, but just to meet with people and talk with about things like finances and curriculum. So who's going to start this round of questions?
For that, we'll start with Mr. Taylor. Mr. Paul Williams, and go to my right, your left.
I think that we are pretty accessible, transparent-wise, online. Contact with us. You can reach any of us, computer-wise or phone-wise, and we're glad to do that. I would welcome the town hall meetings. We had some of those earlier this year, in 2015. And to get the input from our folks, I would be glad to do that.
I think we're going to go around to Mr. Merritt.
I would think this is probably one of the most important topics that we'll discuss tonight. Increase in public and parental participation will be mandatory if we plan on increasing the student performance within our schools. I think we need to start by providing as much information to the public as possible, but we need to do it in a way that we do it before they ask for it. I submitted information request a couple weeks ago, and I got the information back, and I was able to find it online through the help of the school system, and it worked out good, except for it took me six steps, six different clicks of the mouse to find information. We need to try to condense that and make it a little more user-friendly. I plan to keep my social media accounts and websites active and provide information to the public after the election. I want to promote board meetings and agenda and explain to people ahead of time what's going to be discussed, and then afterwards give them a recap.
I agree with Mr. Wiggins. I think we're pretty accessible to the public. Phone numbers are obviously listed. We receive phone calls. We receive emails from parents and others with concerns. And I know either as individual board members or the chairman would certainly respond to that and direct that issue to the appropriate staff member at the central office where it is is handled. Of course, we would follow up. I know at the board meetings, we had opportunities for public participation, either on the agenda items or at the very end for anything. As with any meeting, you have guidelines and policies you have to abide by. We're in the business of educating children. We don't deal with water and sewer unless we're building a school building. We're dealing with children. We're dealing with personnel. At one time, the school board did float their meetings around the county. And to make sure we had a meeting of Detson or Richlands and so forth, but that didn't work as well as they thought. So we're back to a one home base, and I feel like we're pretty accessible. So it's just a matter of letting us know.
I think we are as accessible as we can be. I don't believe any citizen has contacted me by phone or email that I have not responded. And my general response is that I refer that message to the person who can address it better than I can, because we're not always sitting there on the ins and outs of everything, and there may be a situation that we don't truly know about. On the public record side, though, there are lots of times that we get public records, and we try as diligently as we can to make those requests timely. However, when you request those at the end of a semester, when we're doing grades and trying to do all of those things for the high school students to move up, that's a difficult time for two people to try to get those particular grades. We have had town meetings. They have not been very well attended, but we've done so with a good intent, because we want to show people that we want to hear from you. We're your liaison.
Ms. Turner.
Could you repeat the question for me?
Sure. The basic question is about the accessibility of the school system. How would you rate the accessibility, and do you have any ideas that would improve accessibility to the public?
Community having to come to the school board or come to us as far as the meetings and so forth, but yet we get out into the township, we get out into the community, we go out into the schools a little bit more just to show ourselves. I don't know if this is a practice, but this is something that I would like to see done, that we get out into the community a little bit more, not so much as in our meetings, monthly meetings, but just to get out, outside of those meetings. I would be in favor of a town hall meeting. I think those meetings serves as a great opportunity, once again, for the community to see us outside of just regular meetings.
Okay, we have a couple of rules. And Mr. Mayor, you, if we follow the order of questions, you will be first, and then we'll go to Ms. Thomas. And Mr. Wiggins, are you holding yours up?
Yes.
Then we're going to change that, and we'll let Mr. Wiggins go first, and then we'll go to Mr. Mayor.
You know, just plain and simple, as a board member, I have nothing to hide and no reason to hide anything, so I'm as transparent as you can get. I'm in the business of helping students and helping teachers and helping parents and accessibility. In my 4 years on the board, I have visited every school and every community. And I welcome people to call me or contact me on the computer. It doesn't matter to me. I'm in the business of helping students.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, and I'm sorry, that was the 30, the rebuttals will be 30 seconds, so we just want to make that, I'm going to make that clear. That was not your fault. The timer was set.
That's okay. I appreciate it.
You did a good job. You stopped it right at about the right time.
I just ran out of time. I would like to add that I would also like to research the idea of public streaming our meetings. We got archives, you know, the meetings are recorded or shown on G10, and they're archived, but it takes several days for people to be able to view those. If we could live stream those for the people who can't attend the meetings, but can you view them? That would be nice. I would also like to see that public comments maybe get answered. I understand for interest of time at a meeting, we need to limit the time limits of the questions, but with only one or two speakers, I think we can give them a minute or two to answer their questions.
Thank you. And Ms. Thomas.
I just wanted to follow up and say that the Board of Education that I sit on is visible in the schools. We do go to plays. We go to basketball games and football games. We go to spring concerts and winter concerts. We are actively involved in what is going on. Math counts is coming up. We'll be there. So the public knows that we are available in a different venue than being in the board, at the board meetings. One of the things that I would say about, I'm going to stop there, but thank you for letting me have that 30 seconds.
Okay. It goes away quickly,
doesn't it? It does.
Another question that we have had submitted, and one that was actually on my list, would be, what is your opinion of Common Core?
We will start this question with
Jonathan Merritt, and
Merritt
will go to,
Mr. Wiggins and move this way.
Common Core, it's a federal reach into local education. We need to get rid of it. And I've actually termed it, I've written papers on it, I've talked to people about it. It is basically state-sponsored extortion. They put their rules out to us, and they tell us if we don't follow them, follow their opinion, that we can't have their money. Less than 10%, 9.5% of Onslow County's 14-15 budget came from federal funds. Let's get rid of their money, and then we can get rid of their rules. I don't agree with the way they teach English or language arts. We got to go back to phonics. You can't teach a kid to read by memorization, and you don't teach a kid to add, subtract, multiply, and divide by estimating. We need to go back to classical education, go back to basics. We need to go back to teaching reading, writing, and arithmetic, and let's get rid of all the excess regulations.
Mr. Wiggins?
Common Core may come by that name, but it started a long time ago with No Child Left Behind. It didn't just start. And trying to set up a level playing ground or whatever kind of playing ground you want to call it. But I do agree there. I would like to see the federal government out of education. Let our states control it. When we tried to put in the Common Core, it was brought in too quickly. It wasn't explained to parents. It wasn't explained to teachers. And it was a disaster from the start.
Common Core, I am opposed to Common Core. Reason for it, it takes away the state, parents, teachers, access and involvement in our children's education here locally. Anytime a program suggests that me as a parent cannot have a word or a say concerning my child's education, I don't think that is a good program for my child to be in or any other child, because as parents, we're stakeholders. We are the primary stakeholders in our children's education. And if we cannot have a word to say, or if our child is having a problem or a concern, we cannot go collaborate with the teachers to try to change and get our children on the right course. If that is taken away from us, that is not good at all.
Thank you. Ms. Thomas.
Well, I've heard Common Core so much that I really don't even like to talk about it. I think that Common Core intent of Common Core was probably really good for us in a transient community. However, it was implemented at a time without proper training, with no resources, and we still are limited in instructional resources. I would like to go back to some of the basic things that we've taught as we were children, but at the same time, I know that the future of education is not just those little basics. I moderate Academic Derby every Tuesday for 12 years, and I've seen the math that kids have to know today that we probably learned in high school, and they're learning in third and fourth grade. So there's got to be a different way to deliver our curriculum. And if it means going back to the old-fashioned ways with new tools, then I'm all for it.
Mr. Taylor?
I am adamantly opposed to any federal mandate regarding curriculum and standards. I do believe it should be at the state level. But based on my research, information that we have all received and we've read about, that Mr. Wiggins mentioned No Child Left Behind. Well, that came out with an accountability model, mainly with providing more testing for students throughout the country. The problem was there was a misalignment. Each state had their own standards, sort of singing off a different page of music. And I think the Common Core was an attempt by 45 governors, not on a nonpartisan basis, to try to align national standards with the assessment. I think you can talk to any principal in any school. There's a lot of transition, kids coming from all over the country into our school systems. Even the Department of Defense, Camp Lejeune schools have adopted Common Core. But I think, just like with anything else, every 5 years, you assess it, you make changes. I don't care if you call it Common Core or just Standard Course of Study. There's a process in place to make it, to correct it. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's do a little bit different here. Let's go ahead and pick so they can listen to my question. I'm getting sort of, these things are going to get sort of complex because I'm trying to work in a lot of different audience questions with some of those that we had already prepared. And I hope you'll bear with me. Mr. Merritt, you'll be the first one up this time. And I believe that time this time we'll just go straight to your left. I have to kind of turn, and I'm not smart enough to figure that out. Okay. This is kind of a question that a couple different people have asked in different ways. And they've asked, do you sit in a classroom? Do you have children, or do you see the homework they're doing every day? Or the way I wanted to, I guess it's just, how familiar are you with what's going on? Your candidates for the Board of Education, how familiar are you with what's going on in the classroom? And one of the questions that we have asked before, and I think this is a good way of putting it, when was the last time you visited a public school and what did you observe? So if you could take all of that and maybe turn it into one answer, I sure would appreciate it. Mr. Merritt.
Do I sit in a classroom or visit a classroom? My son just started kindergarten in Rich Lanes Primary School. But I teach at the community college level, and I get to observe our graduates every day. And one disturbing thing to me is just up until this past fall, before the community college and the high school went to, in a collaboration of a 2.5 GPA would keep you from having to take any placement tests, we were seeing 75 to 80% of incoming students having to take remedial math and English. That really bothered me. But you go to the school. Yeah, I go to, I'm at Richlands Primary School every day, dropping my son off, picking him up, and I'm in constant contact with his teacher. I do homework with him every night, and I'm very frustrated more with the math and the phonics because they teach him how to read based on memorization. They teach him what they call sight words. As long as you can visually identify it, then you know what the word is. But what happens when you don't know what that sound means? They're not teaching sounds. They're not teaching phonics.
I was in the schools quite often when I was working with the school system. I remain active in the schools as a board member. In order to assess what is going on, you've got to be down in the trenches at the school level, in the classroom. Principals will escort me around their schools and show me programs. I stand over children as they're doing their homework or doing assignments and so forth. And I'm very active in helping judge the senior projects at the high schools and just actually seeing what is being done in the schools. As a adjunct instructor at the college, I work with students every day in helping them not only with their music but anything else that they need, because that's what we're trying to do, is get these kids to move to graduation and to pursue a higher level of education. So it's a constant process. You're always in the schools learning.
Well, I'm in the schools quite often. When I was the director of technology in Onslow County Schools, I was in the schools probably 95% of my time. Now I don't have that much time to be there, but and every Tuesday I'm at Southwest High School. I'm there for about 5 hours. During exams, I proctor or monitor test. During the spring, I do that for the elementary schools. Also, I'm involved in the activities that schools are participating in. I think it's important for us to interact with kids. They'll tell you the truth, y'all. You need to go. They'll tell you the truth. You'll know what's going on. I've seen the work they've done. I've mentored them, read to them, as well as most of my board members have. I think that my visibility in the schools is pretty much seen on a weekly basis.
I'm in the schools quite often. Like I said earlier, I am a substitute teacher, so I don't just attend one school. I'm in many schools around Onslow County throughout the week. As far as my involvement, like I said earlier as well, I have a foster son. He attends one of the middle schools here, excuse me. And we're constantly on the computer doing homework. And Edmodo, I'm very familiar with Edmodo, how it works and function and not function and all that good stuff. I also have a conference with my son's teacher on Friday, so I'll be in the schools on Friday as well. So, yes.
Mr. Wiggins.
Well, as I said earlier, 39 years of experience as a teacher and then as assistant principal and as principal and then coaching in the afternoons, I've always been with students because I believe the foundation to getting children to learn is all about relationship. If you have a special relationship with them, they'll follow you anywhere. And being in the schools, I'm always in the schools, to their ball games, to their concerts, to their special meetings. I love doing that. Even as a principal, I did not stay in the office. I was in the hallways and in the classrooms. That's where it's at, and that's where you find out the truth and what you need to do in the classrooms with the students.
Okay, thank you. I want to ask you this question. Here's a quote from the current state superintendent of public instruction, and she was talking about how parents can evaluate schools. One of the best questions that a parent can ask is, how is my child student doing? How is my child learning at this school? How is my child growing and learning each day? If those questions were asked about Onslow County Schools as a system, what do you think would be the answer? Mr. Taylor, we'll start with you, and we will move then to Mr. Merritt and over to Mr. Wiggins and back down.
I'm going to respond as a board member and as well as a parent. Very simply, I sit down with my teachers, on an annual basis. We go through their work. Tell me about their strengths. What are some areas of needed improvement? I didn't rely on one test at the end of the year to indicate to me that they're doing well, because there are a lot of other opportunities, evidences that are out there that they do on a daily basis, on a weekly basis. It's constant communication. You cannot wait till the end of the school year to start asking questions. It's something that you just have to monitor daily. I think with our schools, any teacher will be happy to sit down with you along with the principal and go in with an open mind. And because every child, I can tell you, they don't learn at the same pace. Just like in this room, as adults, you don't learn at the same pace. You work with each individual child.
Ms. Thomas.
Okay. Well, you know, parents need to be involved in school. And if they are at the school level, they know what's going on. They know what's good. They know what's happening. They know what might need to be improved. Going to PTA meetings, being on a school leadership team, volunteering as a mentor after school, even going to proctor tests gives you an idea of what's happening in that school. You cannot remove yourself as a parent, as a community person from the school level and think that you know everything that's going on, because all you hear is what somebody's saying. But if you're there, you can see that. We encourage our community people, and we beg you to come and help us monitor our tests. We would love for you to come in our schools and see what's going on, but that's what parents should do. We would love for them to be there.
Ms. Turner.
Could you repeat the question for me,
Stanley? Yes. Well, basically this,
I mean, how does a parent, what questions should a parent be asking? How is my student doing? How is my child learning at this school, and is my child growing and learning each day? And then if you were to answer that question for the school system now, what would your answer be?
I would say basically what Ms. Thomas has said, not just ask the question and wait for a response, but actually get involved and going to see, to lay eyes on. I believe parents, I'm a parent of a school age child, and I take a true intrusive part of my my son's education. I don't wait on the end of progress reports or mid-course progress reports or end-of-course progress reports. I don't wait on those reports. Like I said, I try to schedule conferences throughout the grading period and don't just wait on those times, because if we take a reactive approach to our children's education, we're going to be left behind, and so are our children.
Mr. Wiggins.
I think in our system, every school, every staff, and the system as a whole, the key word to me is teamwork, and it's a triangle. You have your school staff, you have your parents, and you have your students. And you must build a relationship with all of them, and you must ask the difficult questions, and you must go and find the answers when those questions come up. I had a saying that I always used with my staff, expect and inspect. And don't wait all the time for people to come and ask you. Go seek them out. I had a standard every day at White Oak High School. I invited a senior to my office. And you might say, well, that's a little bit late. No, not really, because by that time, they have some real input that they are willing to give you and will give you. And they'll help you in the right direction.
Mr. Merritt.
I apologize, but I'm going to have to ask you to repeat the question.
Sure. I was there was a quote from the state superintendent who said the best way, talking about questions that parents should ask in evaluating schools, how is the student doing? How is the student learning? Is the student growing each day? If you apply that question to not an individual school but the school system, what do you think the response would be?
If you apply it to the school system, then that would depend on whether or not the parent was asking from the half of the children that are below grade level or the 50% that are at or above grade level, because it's pretty much a close shift. I would say that the students are growing, but I think they're still far behind. If my son scores a 50 on a test, 40 on a test this week, and a 50 next week, he grew by 10%, which is awesome. Ms. Atkinson loves to talk about growth, but he's still failing at the end of the day. Student performance is an issue, and I don't think it's a teacher issue. I don't want anybody to get that idea that it's a teacher issue. This is a policy issue, and it starts in Washington, D.C. It trickles down to Raleigh, and now it's at Onslow County. We have to get rid of the restrictive policies that are hamstringing our teachers, and we need to go back to basics of education and stop testing these kids to death.
Okay, and who's going to get the next question?
Tawana Turner.
Ms. Turner, and we'll move to the left, which will mean we'll end up with Mr. Wiggins.
All right.
Okay, the question is this: how can the school system ensure the right balance between meeting the needs of college-bound students and providing instruction for those students who are more focused on a trade?
Repeat that again for me, Ms. Turner.
How can the school system ensure the right balance between meeting the needs of college-bound students and providing instruction for those students who are more focused on a trade?
At this present time, if a child display interest in going to college or interest in a trade, I think that should be the first and foremost, seeing what's the interest of that child. If the child is interested in attending college through information from visiting a guidance counselor or doing a type of assessment of seeing what they're interested in, or if a child is showing interest in a vocational skill. I know in high schools, in many of the high schools here in Onslow County, they have vocational skills classes, and a lot of those students do very well in those classes. And some of those students do go on and do vocational education via vice going to a four-year university.
Ms. Thomas.
Thank you. In Onslow County right now, we have the career and college promise. Our students have the ability to be dual enrolled in high school, as well as at courses at Coastal Carolina. We also have career readiness that we address, and that is helping our students receive certificates at the vocational level at a particular trade that we have in our career towers. That provides that student with a certificate, then they can go to Coastal and get in an advanced class, or James Sprunt, where Mr. Merritt teaches. They can go ahead and have some of those beginning classes for a particular voc ed trade out of the way. We're looking forward to a future endeavor in doing an early college, where we will partner with the community college here, that will allow our kids to graduate with a two-year degree as well as their high school diploma. So I think we're doing a lot. We're having a struggle, though, in finding a lot more vocational ed teachers for our high school programs.
Mr. Taylor?
As a teacher, I have always, and as a parent, I have always believed that you should encourage children to maximize their potential, not to say, well, you're not good in this area, you're not good in this area. To maximize their potential and to do the very best you can, whatever you decide to choose. I know in Onslow County Schools for decades, we've had some quality programs in career and technical education, and there's been emphasis on preparing children for college. That's just not a four-year degree. We're talking about at least maybe a two-year degree. But a high school diploma is absolutely minimum in today's society. You need more than that. And say, well, I'm just going to work on auto mechanics. It's just a different arena out there with the technology and the demand for reading skills and so forth. I do believe, hopefully in Onslow County, that one day we can have a center where we can put everything under one roof where children can benefit from all of those skills.
Mr. Merritt.
I'm going to have to ask you to repeat the question one more time.
Sure. How can the school system ensure the right balance between meeting the needs of college-bound students and providing instruction for those students who are more focused on a trade?
Like Mr. Taylor said, we need to start, one, because in my field, it is technology-driven. It's very, you have to be able to read, you have to be able to really understand, do math. So we need to start at the bottom. We need to start with educating our elementary school kids in how to properly read, how to properly read for comprehension, how to do basic math. That's where we need to start at. We don't need to confuse it. We don't need to add anything to it. We need to go back to the way they taught it when everybody on this board took it. Then we need to whether it's a vocational high school standalone or it's a bigger partnership with Coastal Carolina, we have to expand our offerings for career and technical education, especially in the skilled trades. Right now, 50% of the workforce is reaching retirement age. If we don't have somebody to replace them with, what are we going to do? Can you wire your own house? Can you fix your own car? Can you plumb your own house? What are we going to do if nobody's there to replace the people that are retired?
And we'll start back around with Mr. Wiggins.
As a high school principal for 17 years, this was certainly an important area for me, trying to balance the career, tech, trades, and the academic. I knew that every child was not going to a four-year college or university. So at White Oak High School, at that time, cut that clock off just a minute. Back before Santa had a beard long ago, we only had 24 units in our system. And that locked children in to taking four Englishes, so many maths, and so many. And we weren't getting any career tech courses. So at White Oak High School, we piloted the block schedule where a children through 4 years could have 32 opportunities so children could get in these courses, A. Two, we needed more of those courses. And you're exactly right. Someone's going to have to wire our house. Someone's going to have to do masonry work. Someone's going to have to do carpentry. And it's probably not those kids that are going on to the four-year universities. So we need first to set up prerequisites to set them up for success. Offer the courses and make sure they do a good job in that and get their certifications. And then they can go on to our community colleges and our four-year schools afterwards if they want to.
Mr. Barrett has a rebuttal.
Well, not a rebuttal. I ran out of time again. I have reviewed these last few meetings or the last few candidate forms, and it seems that every candidate sits up here and seems to support a vocational high school or expanding vocational education. Yet, since July of 2014, I've got every board agenda there, and it's not on the board agenda. It's never brought up in a meeting. It's always good when you're in front of the camera to talk about it, but no action is ever taken to try to put forth a plan to actually do it.
Although I was elected on to the school board in 2012, the previous school boards for the past decade have been planning for a career and technical launch center. It was part of the construction and improvement program. The problem is, like with anything else, you got to have money to build it. It was a great idea. It's still on the table, but the plan has been in place. We're looking, hopefully we can have students from all each of our high schools. In the meantime, we have towers. Right now, that is plan B. Hopefully one day we can put all that, but the plan has been in place for over a decade.
Okay, and we'll start the next round of questions with
Mr. Jonathan Merritt.
Mr. Merritt.
And go to my right, your left.
All right, and we'll go to Mr. Taylor and go into that direction. What ideas would you suggest for holding or cutting the cost of meeting the school's building needs? Holding down or cutting the cost of meeting the school system's building needs.
Well, from my research right now, it looks like that Onslow County Schools is probably growing somewhere around 300 students a year, give or take a few. So in a military community that such as ours, that the population is student population rise and fall based on national security issues, it's kind of hard to really put a set number on that. But I think we need to go to the county. The county Board of Commissioners are responsible for constructing school buildings and maintaining those buildings. And I think we need to ask them to let's prioritize a little bit. Let's have a bond referendum on building a jail. Let's have a bond referendum on building a new maintenance facility. Let's not always put the schools to a vote, because school construction to a vote. Let's put some of these other buildings to a vote that we're building. That's what my opinion would be, is to go to the county commissioners and let's prioritize schools over some of these other issues.
Mr. Taylor.
Very simply, stop growing. No more students allowed in your school system. That will do it. But Onslow County is one of the fastest growing counties in the state. We, along with Pender County, New Hanover County, and Elizabeth City area. When Onslow County grows, so does the school system. We all talk about growth. We want to grow. We want to have more business. They're going to bring families. They're going to bring children. And it's our constitutional requirement is to provide an education for them in the classrooms that are appropriate settings. I think it requires constant communication with the county commissions, as stated, required by law to provide the facilities. Our staff constantly updates the county commissions on growth. You got to have open communication. You got to be proactive instead of reactive. You've got to plan. You got to have a vision, and you got to prepare for it.
Ms. Thomas?
Well, we have a construction plan that we have prioritized, and we know what we need to do. And of course, the commissioners are charged with funding that, and they've been very helpful in the last 2 years to help us build two schools that would not have started at this time. And we have four other schools that will be coming out of that prioritization. Our particular overcrowdedness is a little bit different than maybe some school systems. Every month, we have a school's entire number of children move from one district to another. They may not all move to the same district, but they're so transient, they move all over. So it's hard to get a grasp on what that school really has. We can back that up with some data and figures. We've looked at how we could partner with the base, and the base has come to us and said, how can we partner with you to utilize their facilities that are certainly under capacity right now?
Ms. Turner.
I believe it should be a more collaborative effort between coordinating between the school district, the county, and the city for and the planners regarding schools and school growth and development. Like it's been said previously here, Onslow County is a growing county with military transferring in and transferring out, developments in subdivisions. It just needs to be a better collaborative effort in planning.
Mr. Wiggins.
Two or three things. We as a school board, we're not in the business of taxing or raising money. We have to look to someone else for that. But when you're talking about a school system, as Mr. Merritt said, 300 new students a year, hiring 250 teachers a year, hiring 10 brand new teachers every year, you got to have seats to put those children in. You got to have classrooms to put the students and the teachers in. And you're looking at building new facilities, you have to do that. Where are you going to put these folks? We're talking about the prerequisites to take care of children, technology needs, the resources needed to give every child an equal and equitable opportunity to be the very best they can be and to grow educationally. And the Career Tech Center that we talked about, I would love to have it, but we got to have the money to have it. And the last thing I'll say is this. Putting money in building is a good problem to have. Just think if it had to go the other way and you didn't have and you had to close schools and people will lose their job and be leaving the community. So I would rather grow than die.
Okay, and the next question will be addressed to Ms. Turner.
I'm going to go to my left, your right.
And so we'll go to Ms. Thomas after that. Okay, I'm going to try to, again, put together some questions, and I will tell you that the subject is sex education. We've had one member of the audience who's asked about the sexual health initiatives for teens. That's a federal program that's aimed at military communities. We have had another person who wants to know what role teaching birth control should have in any sex education program that we would have in Onslow County schools. And then we have the question that's posed in a more general way, and this is the one I'm going to pose and let you talk about whatever it is you want to talk about on this topic. But how important is it to you for curriculum provided to students and children to match the values within our community?
Very important to me that what we're teaching our children about sex education, it match our values. Presently, we have shift NC, the initiative here in North Carolina, soon trying to come here in North Carolina as far as teen pregnancy prevention. But however, I believe sexual health goes more than just pregnancy prevention. It deals with the whole person. A holistic approach should be taken when we're dealing with sexual health for children. When you're dealing with sexual education, it's not just physical. It's emotional, it's intellectual, it's spiritual, and it's social. And I believe we every effort should be placed on building healthy relationships, self-esteem, building our children up to know who they are before we just subject them to what type of birth control to use. Because most of them, their prefrontal cortex is not even developed at the ages that we're trying to introduce these methods to them, and they do not understand that.
I agree with a lot of things Ms. Turner said. I'm a former health educator and did teach family life education. I taught family life education from a physiological standpoint, and then we talked about the social issues that were involved in that. And I think parents need to play a role in that in our churches. And a lot of times they invite Shift NC, the Pregnancy Resource Center, they invite other agencies that have the background in teaching that to come in to talk with their youth. I'm not sure that the school's place is to teach birth control, but I do think that the school's place is to teach values. I think the school's place is certainly to give children accurate information, even if that information is sometimes alarming. I think we need to give them accurate information, certainly do not want to give them false information. Teaching family life education is more than just dealing with pregnancy. It's about making good decisions and making good choices and knowing what you're responsible for.
Ditto, ditto. I was not a health educator, but one of the hats that I wore at the central office was being director of health and PE along with the arts. How you can make that combination fit, I don't know, but I was given the task. I recall about 20 years ago when the Onslow County School Board, along with the North Carolina General Assembly, adopted the family life abstinence until marriage policy. And my job was to try to implement that program with materials and training the teachers and so forth. Family abstinence until marriage is the core of the family life program. And parents have to sign off of that, just like if they want their child to learn more about sex education with the comprehensive program, they have to sign off. And the PE teacher, who is also the health teacher, is the one responsible for teaching. I just believe, again, I just reiterate what they've said, but I think the parents have a more important role in teaching that than the schools.
This is an issue that I'm going to have a lot more research on. I wish we could go and leave the birds and the bees in my living room and let me teach my kids that way, but unfortunately, again, we've got regulations from the state and the federal government on what we have to provide. I can tell you that as a parent, I want my child taught abstinence first, but I can also tell you that children, what children are taught and what they do are two different things. I was a part of the smoke-free class of 2000. And not too long after that, I smoked my first cigarette. So, but it, as a board member goes and as a policy goes, right now board policy states that primary prevention of sexually transmitted diseases in pregnancy will be abstinence. Contraceptives and the demonstration of their use aren't allowed on school property, and that abortion will not be taught as a form of birth control. Until I do a lot more research on this issue, I have to agree with that policy.
I agree with just about everything that has been said here, and we have to worry about the whole child. And presently, our policy mostly is abstinence. But Ms. Turner, the field that you work in, when you see the pregnancy rate in Onslow County, that's not getting it done, is it? There's so much more that we need to do, and we need to be honest. We're going to have to look at this program because we need to teach our children. But it will have to be a teamwork with parents, churches, schools. It's an area that is really important to Onslow County at this time.
Yeah. I just wanted to here in Onslow County. The pregnancy rate here in Onslow County seems to be, was reported in Daily News on last year, and that it was one of the highest rates in the state of North Carolina. However, if you look at the statistics of everything, the ages of those young ladies that were polled, or the data, is from ages 18 and 19. And those, most of those young ladies are coming from base or the military, where they're married at the age of 18 and 19. So if you take that out of the those young ladies out of the equation, the pregnancy rate here in Onslow County falls quite in the middle of that, of those that data.
Anybody else? Okay. All right, who are we going to start with next? I think we're down to the last two or three questions here. Ms. Thomas, you'll get a first crack at this one.
And go to my right, your left.
And we'll go to Ms. Turner first.
Yes.
After that. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the changes that the state, or I guess I think it is the state here, talking about the reporting, the performance ratings, and the grades that they were, that were given out to schools and school systems. First off, my question was, what's your impression of how well we did? And then an audience member wants to know, what do you think about the changes that were made in that? Are they working for you? Ms. Thomas.
First of all, I really don't like the grades. I think that it gives a false impression of what's being successfully done in our schools. Our parents have not come forward with a lot of issues about the grades. I think they're looking at the fact that the successes of the schools have lots of dimensions of them within the school, not just that grade. The grades today are 80% based on testing, 20% on growth, and I think we have to grow before we can do well on test. I'm not sure that I would want to do anything differently with testing other than to reduce testing and to reduce the change the grades. And if you notice, looking at data, the grades were changed for 2 years, so it made the grades look worse last year. And as they continue to make changes without allowing us any difference in curriculum, they're going to continue to look bad.
Could you repeat the question for me, sir?
Yes, we want to talk about the performance grades that the state has handed down for our local school, to the school level, and also the county schools as a whole. Have you studied those grades? What is your impression? Do you like that system for reporting on school progress?
No, I do not like the grades that our schools here in Onslow County received. I do not. They take 80% of testing, EOCs, EOGs. Those tests are mandated or standardized via the Common Core standard. So taking those tests themselves, taking it out of the equation, and concentrating on a different approach, such as growth, I think our schools will stand a better chance as far as grading. I do not like EOCs and EOGs. Those tests, once again, like I said, they're standards that collaborate with the Common Core standards. So I do not like the grades that our schools receive. We have a lot to do if we look at the grades of our schools here in Onslow County. Basically, all of them failed, really, with 9 schools receiving Ds, and out of 8 middle schools, 5 received Ds and 3 low Cs. So that, no.
Mr. Wiggins?
I'm totally opposed to the present grading system. I don't think it's fair. You're not testing the whole school. For example, and I've given this example before, take a baseball player. He hits, he gets an average, he steals bases, he bats runs in, all these things. And he's judged by all those things. But now our schools, they pick out 4 or 5 things and judge our school by just those 4 or 5 things. If you're going to judge it, let's do it all. One other comment, testing. Here's one former high school principal that, if I had my way, we would do away with all the state testing. I'd rather have teachers teaching than that one test. You're judging a child or a school on a test for one day. How about all the other days, all the good things that are going on? Many other states have already tried this system and already thrown it out. And here we are using that system. So I am totally opposed to that.
Mr. Barrett.
I would have to agree that I'm opposed to the current system. I was opposed to one 2 years ago. I was opposed to the one before that. We have to come up with some way to assess schools that we don't change every 2 years or 3 years. What is that doing to our teachers and, more importantly, our kids? When they go from being assessed one way to having it changed in 2 years without any allowance to change their curriculum or change their way of educating. I mean, we'll never succeed at that. We have to come up with something for the state of North Carolina or for Onslow County, whichever way we set up, that works for us. We can't keep letting Washington and all these other places push this stuff into Onslow County. We need to make these decisions for ourselves. And we need to do so with less testing because, as was stated before, we can't keep testing them to death. We're not getting the results we need. It's not working. We've got to come up with a different way of doing it.
I, too, am opposed to the current grading of A through F. This is state mandated, not by the federal government. But when you combine the state and the federal governments with all the excessive testing that's going on, pre-testing, post-testing, it is excessive. Teachers want time to teach. They want time to teach. This program has proven to fail in other states. However, our state legislature continues with the program. About a year or so ago, our board was introduced to the new system of grading. Staff came in and sort of dissected everything and presented it to us. We've had board members who were former principals, teachers, and we all came out of that meeting saying, that's about as clear as mud. The General Assembly has made an attempt to try to clear it, make it simple for people to understand, and they have not succeeded at that. They want to look at it as if you're going into a restaurant and you see an A or B grade. It's not a true reflection of our schools.
This is a real testing measure. I've not had one parent, not a single one, say to me that they're pleased with that system or they think that their school is not good. They're very pleased with their schools. And they know that grading system is not good.
Well, we got a lot of topics we could cover, but we're kind of running out of time. So what we're going to do is we're going to, first I'm going to do is thank you for adhering to the time limits as well as you did. You're all good students as well as good candidates. We're going to start now with the summations. You have 1 minute, and we will start with Ms. Turner. And we will go to Mr. Wiggins on the right and move around that way so Ms. Thomas would be last. So your summation, please.
I just want to thank everyone for being here this afternoon and giving me an opportunity to express my desire to be a servant unto your to the county. Once again, I appreciate your time for allowing me to do such thing.
Thank you.
You know, with all of my 39 years, I never made decisions that were good for Paul Wiggins. I made decisions that were good for students. I mentioned earlier, when we went to the block schedule, when we started school earlier in the day, I was worried about students who were having to walk home or go home after their practices in the afternoon in the dark. And that's my commitment, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. I want every child, I don't care if they're male, female, white, black, little, big, to have an equal and equitable opportunity to be the very best they can be and to grow the way they should grow educationally. Thank you for allowing us to speak with y'all today. Thank you for being here.
Mr. Merritt.
Again, thank you for coming out. This group actually turned out a whole lot larger than what I was planning on, and that's nice. Everybody should come out and listen to everything a candidate has to say before they make a decision and not base it off one newspaper article or one thing they see on TV. I believe I've got the experience and the knowledge necessary to help the Onslow County Board of Education and the students. I believe I have a plan to help the Onslow County Board of Education and their students. One thing that needs to be noted is every decision that I would make as a candidate for Board of Education will affect my life and my family for the next 15 years. As my son is a kindergartner and my daughter starts Richlands Primary School in 3 years, I have a vested interest in every decision that will be made, whether it's based on taxes for property or it's based on curriculum or getting rid of Common Core or school construction. Every decision that I make will affect my family for the next 15 years. And I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Mr. Taylor.
I'm running for re-election to the Board of Education for the same reasons I ran and served during my first term. That is to provide opportunities for student success, make decisions in the best interest of children, and be an advocate for the Onslow County Schools. I believe that teachers are the foundation for all professions that you all enjoy today, and we must provide all the support and encouragement to them to help them inspire students to maximize their potential. Our students, our staff, our school system are recognized each year at the state and national levels for their many achievements. They're the ones who continue to make Onslow County Schools one of the best in the state. I will continue to work hard on our facility needs and support our teachers and our school leaders in providing a quality education for our children. Thank you.
Ms. Thomas.
This is my 12th year being on the Board of Education, and it has been a very wonderful experience. It's been a heartbreaking experience sometimes when you deal with suicides of your students, illnesses, the things that are beyond the school's role to help. But our community of schools come forward and they do that. I'm a strong advocate, as I've always said, and I've always believed, still believe it, that education is the one factor in a child's life that can level the playing field, can even that playing field for all kids, no matter where they come from, what their families do, how much money they have, if they want to go to college or if they want to be in a trade. Education, public education, is the thing that can prepare them for that. Thank you for coming and listening to us today. I know that we've shared a lot of information, but at the end of the day, we want to do what is best for your kids and for our teachers and our community. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you again, candidates, for your participation and cooperation with the rules. This is a very big election, of course, for the Board of Education, because this is the election. This is not a primary. This is the real deal, so whoever wins in March here will be seated on the board. So that's a little bit different than some of the other races that'll be on the ballot, so we want the county's voters to keep that in mind. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Lorette Ligon, the president of the Onslow County, Jacksonville Onslow County Board of, I'll get it right in a minute, Chamber of Commerce.
Somebody get him, didn't he? I just want to thank you all for being here, because you provided me personally with some valuable information that I will certainly have with me when I go to the polls. I also want to thank again our corporate sponsor, Duke Energy, our media sponsor, The Daily News, and our partners, the City of Jacksonville and the City of Jacksonville Media Services. I want to thank the Deputy Director of the Jacksonville Onslow Economic Development, Dan Oliver, who also serves as the Chamber's Chair of Governmental Affairs, our moderator up to that last bit, and Chamber Board member, Elliot Potter.
I got to go to remedial.
And thank you, Sandra Gilmer, for keeping Elliot on point. Thank you to our forum coordinator, many years in the running, Janet Bowen, our timekeeper, first time out, business services manager, Anna Davin, and chamber staff members, Sabrina Thomas and Melissa Maloney, for their assistance. If you missed any part of this forum, Onslow, be sure and check the listings for G10, because it will be rebroadcast and the dates and times will be available. And lastly, remember, your vote does count. One-stop voting begins on Thursday, March the 3rd, and runs through Saturday, 12th, and Election Day is March the 15th. Thank you for joining us. This concludes our forum.